Hello and welcome to the program. I am Deji Bademosi. Now, local governments in Nigeria are recognized as the third tier of government, responsible for maintaining relations with people in their locality. Ideally, Nigeria's federal system and the constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria provides for independence of local governments. But as most people would tell you, that is only on paper. In reality, that's not the case. All 774 local government areas in the country have for a long time been at the mercy of state governments, of course, and of course state governors, with little or no form of financial independence. Every year, this 774 local government areas get hundreds of billions of naira in allocation to carry out their responsibilities and duties at the local level. But all the monies end up in joint accounts with their respective state governments. The local government chairmen, of course, have little or no say in how the funds meant for their local governments are spent. Their state governors basically call the shots on how the monies are utilized. Now, the net effect is that in virtually all the local government areas in this country, there is little to show for the huge allocation they get every year. The federal government has now decided to do something about the situation, and one of its agencies, the Nigeria Financial Intelligence Unit, NFIU, is getting cracking on the issue. According to the NFIU, cash withdrawal and transactions from state joint government accounts pose the biggest corruption and money laundering and, of course, security threats to good governance at the grassroots level. So beginning from June the 1st, 2019, a new set of guidelines will govern the way the joint account system operates. The account will only exist for the purpose of collecting allocations from the Federation account, but not for disbursement, as is currently the case. Governors, banks, and other financial institutions are now banned from tampering with the allocation of local governments. Under the new guidelines, funds in the joint account meant for local governments would be distributed directly to the various local government areas. And local government chairmen, of course, are barred from making cash withdrawal from any of these local government accounts for a cumulative amount exceeding 500,000 naira per day. And any other transaction must be done through valid checks or electronic funds transfer. The directive, of course, is in compliance with Section 162(8) of the 1999 Constitution as amended, which states that, quote, the amount standing to the credit of local government council of a state shall be distributed among the local government councils of that state and not for other purposes. In ensuring that the orders are not flouted, banks have also been advised to key into the development or face sanctions, both locally and internationally. Now, this is seen as a good news in the fight against corruption in the country. And of course, anti-corruption groups have thrown their weight behind the NFIU on this one. The Senate has also backed the new guidelines, urging all financial institutions to support its implementation. Let's take a listen now to what some of the senators actually said when the issue was discussed at the Senate.
The local government today, they exist, cannot function effectively because they don't have funds. The governors are not giving them the funds that they get from the Federation account. If you look at the Constitution, there are certain functions the local government are supposed to do, and they are specified. They were able to do those functions. But today, honestly, yes, sir, they are unable to do that because they are financially strangulated. They hardly see any money coming from the Federation account.
The time of local administration has come, and I believe we are going to be part and parcel of this fantastic decision to liberate the local government from the shackles of some of the state governors.
We have lying in all the states the National Assembly Bill on the reform of the local government systems, which was part of the last effort of this assembly to amend the Constitution. Now, some governors are still sitting on it. So, in furtherance of this motion, I would just want to use the opportunity to appeal to those states where those bills are still hanging to allow the state assemblies to look into those bills and then take a decision one way or the other. If we're able to do that, it will be one of the best legacies
this assembly will be able to give to Nigerians.
Well, it's quite interesting to see some former governors there backing, staunchly backing this initiative. They are now senators anyway. Joining me now to discuss this further is Nelson Ekwujemi, who is a political analyst, and Lanre Suraj, who heads Civil Society Network Against Corruption, and of course the Human and Environmental Development Agenda header. Gentlemen, thank you very much for coming on the program. Let me start with you, Nelson. I mean, we saw the former governors there coming out strongly in support of this, and you could accuse some of them.
No, I won't accuse them because we don't have the fact, but there were former governors,
yeah. Even though we do not have the fact, that we know that it was a common practice among all the governors in this country, you know, that basically control local government funds.
Sure. So, well, it's a good development, you know, that the issue is on the other feet now. And, you know, they have come out publicly to express, you know, their position has been in tandem with the new policy guideline. So, for me, I think it's a welcome development. It is long overdue. But we also need to take it further, you know, in as much as we are trying to have a clear view of our local government funds, which had always been abused severally by state governments. We also need to have this type of perspective into even state governments and even federal government funds. And why do I say this? We have the states, in the States House of Assembly, we have these committees overseeing the local government. We need to ask, when these committees go to oversee projects or policies or programs of the local government, do they expect this local government to carry out these functions without the necessary resources, which is the money that the local government should have been getting, you know, from the joint account, which the states have, you know, continued to manipulate. So for me, I think it's a wake-up call. And that is why one is very, very happy that we have taken this step. And the best thing for us to do now is to up the ante.
Lanre, I know your group has actually come out in support of this. I mean, I saw the statement that your group actually issued supporting this. But do you think this is the end of corruption at the local government level?
No.
That when you allow local government chairmen to control, you know, have direct access to local government funds, that it ends corruption?
No, not at all. The Constitution actually gave, which is why the Senate had that responsibility that it does decide in support of the new policy, because the Constitution gives some basic responsibilities to the local government. And unfortunately, it created the checks and balances also within the local government, whereas you have councillors in addition to the chairman.
Yeah, that's true.
And the State House of Assembly also sometimes investigate what happens at the local government. So it has even more checks and balances mechanisms than the states, where you only have the House of Assembly that is completely usually bought by many of the times the governors. And what you have,
but it's currently also not impossible to buy for a local government chairman.
No,
to
the
buy
governor. Sometimes it's not just that easy. That's why I said it goes beyond just the councillor. You still have the House of Assembly also supervising what happens in the local government. So it's very difficult sometimes for the local government chairman to buy the councillors and then buy those in the House of Assembly. So it could be a bit tough. But the challenging situation is such that, where you have insecurity, we have insecurity, we have health challenges. Nigeria is reputed as one of the country with the highest out of school children. These are basic responsibilities that are meant to be discharged by the local government in terms of the primary health care, the primary education, market, local government, the traffic that you said Lagos is also renowned as a traffic from state. It's basically because there are no garages in many of the local governments, and the local government completely lost the power to even regulate affairs to the state government. And that goes to the issue of the resources. Many of the state governments don't use the joint account, which is what it's supposed to be for. The JAC is meant to be for the receipt of those money. And then disbursement to the local government for the councillors to decide on how the money will be spent. But what you have seen...
So basically, as we have a state budget, we should have local government budgets
exactly
as well, prepared by the local government chairman, and then approved by the councillors.
But that is supposed to be... No, you can't see that. You can see the brazenness where even in Lagos State, where the governor would say we're building or we're constructing or we're repairing so number of states.
Roads.
It's already a road. That is decided by the governor. That is an erosion of the power of the council at the local government. And that road construction would be done not by the local government, but by the state. And at the end of the day, you can see where it extremely becomes difficult for the local government to even determine the cost, the quality, and also the capacity of the contractors handling it. So when you look at the failure, like I said, where do you say find primary health care across the country? It is extremely difficult for you to see. Where do you find the primary education? That is why you have out-of-school children across the country. The new law by the NFIU is not only going to assist the local government, it's also going to assist in curbing money laundering, corruption, and the
irony is that this is not a new law. The law has always been there. It's just that we've now decided to implement it.
Yeah, that is the point. So it is now to hold even the banks responsible for some of those actions or inactions and ensure that you have a trace of the money as they are spent. If the money were spent by the local government, it becomes very easy for law enforcement agencies and financial regulatory agencies to track what goes to where. But where the money disappears once it gets into JAC account, it's extremely difficult for you to even know which local government was the contract meant for. And that is what is also, like you said, challenging for them in combating the kidnapping situation that you're seeing. Because some of those monies were going to even bury the change to convert to dollars. So there's liquidity that is going on around, and this money are not going into any form of investment or any form of job creation other than from the governor's account, going to contractors' account, going to government house and so.
Nelson, do you think this could also, you know, guarantee the political independence, if you like, of local government officials, especially like the chairman and maybe the councillors? Because what we have seen over time, and it's a standard practice, it's become the norm. Local government chairmen are basically appointed by the governors. Even where you have local government elections, those elections are just mere formality, because at the end of the day, it's still like the governor who appoints. So the governor has his appointees, his local government chairman. Would you expect that this local government chairman now would want to question the governor? And in this case, is there not a chance that, you know, some of these local government chairmen could still be ordered by the governor to, you know, collect this money and then make recourse to them?
Definitely. I don't believe that it will guarantee independence. Everything now depends on the citizenry. If the citizenry are very docile, because in a situation whereby the law, we have been sleeping on this law, it's in our statute books. Now somebody has, or an institution has awakened our consciousness. It is not left for us. My own concern right now with this new policy, what it has generated in my own consciousness, is that the time has now come for us to even look at our constitution and see those functions of even the local government that have been eroded by the states. Because you find out that a lot of times, in order for the states to justify their pillaging the local government funds, they create functions or they take away some of the functions of the local government. It was talking about our local governments that they have become non-functional. You go on the roads, you see traders have turned the express road into a market. And you ask yourself, there's a local government market there, and they are supposed to be within the market. Who oversees such responsibility? So for me, it is not enough that we have this law. I think the wake-up call is now for every Nigerian to now beam the searchlight. We have been too docile when it comes to local government management. And that is why even on election days, when it's time for election for local government, a lot of our people behave as if the local government does not matter. Meanwhile, this is an institution of government, and they are the ones responsible for it.
And you don't think these governors could find a way around this law?
It is not impossible, but it is not enough.
Once
human beings are involved, there's that likelihood. But when they know that they have a very vigilant, and conscious citizenry who are watching, because if NFIU is now tracking and the local government chairman or the local government chairman and the governor want to play games, and they are trying, you know, to manipulate maybe the FIU, because the FIU is made up of human beings. Even if they want to play ball, if they are conscious of the fact that, look, don't put me in trouble, the people are watching. Now, the policy is such that, the policy says that they cannot make withdrawal more than 500,000
per day.
Per day. Anything above that must be by check or, you know, banking system. Okay. That means
wire transfer.
That means it could be tracked. So it is not left for us to say, okay, last month my local government chairman bought 10 vehicles.
And the councillors have a huge role to play here.
Definitely. Even a lot of us don't even know our councillors. So that's where the problem lies. So we need to show more interest in how we are being governed. That is the only way we can get out of the woods.
And I tend to agree with him. And your question is very valid. You know, I can remember the madness about caretaker committee started with a former governor who really wasn't sure he was going to win election because of the political party under which he assumed office.
Even as we speak today, some governors have not.
Yeah, so for 7.5 years, he never conducted a local government election. They appointed administrators, and the others have graduated to the extent that the ruling party in the state wins
everything
seat in local government.
Exactly.
So it goes across across the political party.
Parties,
so you can be sure now. I can bet you they're strategizing on what will be the next abattoirs for them, you know, and also for us as Nigerians. How would they make sure that this does not in any way undermine the access to loot?
Because we're talking about huge amounts of money here.
You know, it's a major cesspool of corruption for them. They don't give an account over it. They only get people responsible for it. And local government, in fact, some of the governors are accused of being so smart such that the local government chairman is allowed to withdraw the money, and the money is taken in cash to the government house of the state, and the local government chairman is giving 5 million, 1 million, 10 million as running costs, and then the rest it doesn't even know.
Thank you very much for bringing that point. How do you think this new guideline now? How do you think it could prevent that from happening? Because that's the reason I asked.
No, because the local government chairman is going to be extremely careful. Because you're going to be taking responsibility for anything that goes on there.
Yeah.
So, and if you say you're paying a money now, because that is the essence of the 500,000 ceiling. So, even if you like, withdraw 500,000 naira every day for the next 1 month.
Which is not impossible.
So, you must be able to then give an account and say, this is what I was doing with 500,000 naira every day. So, you must be able to say, why didn't you then do a transfer to the contractor, issue a check to the contractor? So, and every local government chairperson would also be wary, because if you run the errand for a governor, you'll be the one to answer for it.
So in this case now, I mean, maybe for the first time, or probably for the first time in a very long while, we might begin to see local government get involved in contract awards and all of that.
Yeah, that is going to go back to where that is how it used to be. I remember local government, you know, awarding contracts for not only the waste disposal. I mean, waste disposal, which was supposed to be part of local government, is no more done again. So the process for that, for construction of markets, you know, for garages, cemeteries, primary health care centers. You can see local governments doing it. But now, they're not allowed to award the contract. So the state governor can afford to award a contract for the cost of 10 of the same similar action or project for just one project. The local government chairman would not be able to say anything. They are incapable because of the process of quite a number of them imagining office, how they are anointed by godfathers. One of the outgoing governors, when he couldn't actually manipulate his local government chairman, created almost like a fourth tier, you know, in the state. And that was the structure used to govern the local government without necessarily going directly through the local government. But this is going to make that extremely difficult. He can then do any other thing he wants to do from the state purse. So he can use the state fund to do it, but local government funds would have to go to the local government, administered by the local government, and accounted for by the local government under the new dispensation. And the banks are also, and that's the beauty of it. The sanction, and I'm happy to hear that, would not be just local, would also be international. Such that they would not be allowed, because the highest level of corruption and money laundering in Nigeria is not even by the political office holders. It is through the financial and non-financial institutions, especially our banks. So if they can be sanctioned, where they would not have the international recognition and transaction power again, then that would go a very long way in reducing, even increasing the value of the Naira, reducing kidnapping and money laundering issues.
How do you think, how does this affect this situations? Because we've all often had that kind of situation where governors come out to say, look, they're even being generous to the local governments in the sense that, look, the allocations that local governments get, if you just leave, if you let them use what they have, that it's never enough. So that through the process of the joint account, that as a matter of fact, the state gets to spend more for the local government areas, that what they actually get would not be enough. So going forward, what then happens to situations where the state government, wishes to, say, support a local government?
Well, you know very well, and, you know, we all know that we run a constitutional democracy in which the rights and functions of every tier of government is enunciated in the constitution. So a state government performing its responsibility, I don't think that will be out of place. It will be an act of irresponsibility for a state government if there's crisis or emergency in a part of the state, and you know that the resources of the local government is incapable of addressing such a situation, and you now leave them, you know, to their own fate. I think that would be highly irresponsible. But by and large, what Suraj has rightly said is that if, as a local government chairman, you are collecting 600 million naira, and in your own wiseness, you have decided to take 550 or 580 million and give it to your governor
to manage
for you. At the end of the day, with the people we are going to ask you for 600 million, will be less con, because that's what the Lord says we should do, that you are responsible for managing XY amount of money. So it is not left for you to either make a name for yourself and your family or perish your generation, you know, by compromising your
And perhaps one of the things we also need to see, other than these guidelines, you know, the process of awarding contracts, especially at the local government level, the process needs to be transparent so that people are carried along. People know when these contracts have been awarded, who the contractors are, so that they get involved in the process. Because the fact is that some people have actually expressed their fears in the past that, look, if you allow these local government chairmen to control this huge amount of money, that you make them become very powerful and that the chances that they could get even worse in terms of corruption, that the chances are very high. Imagine allowing a man who probably has never seen 100 million now to control, you know, he now sees 600 million, and then he knows that he has almost the final say now in terms of how the money is utilized. That there could be a danger in that.
There's absolutely no danger. I mean, that is just a campaign, a calumny against the local government chairman and operators. I can tell you, none of the president before becoming a president has never seen an amount that is equal to that of the ideal of Nigeria before. The same thing goes to the governors. None of them in their private enterprise or businesses or offices ever administered amounts as equal as to. So what is, you know, affecting the governors and the president is the same thing with the local government. So the local government chairman is possibly seeing 600 million for the first time, moving from maybe 10 million or 1 million. And the same thing goes to the governor. He's possibly seen, like the governor of Lagos State, he's seen an IGR of about 40 billion naira a month, you know, for the first time, coming from maybe 10 million or 50 million before. So they are on the same pedestal. So it is just a campaign of calumny to justify the actions of the state governors and to amass not only the resources of the local government, but also to erode the constitutional power and responsibilities on the strength of this so-called campaign that you hear this kind of argument. But the most important thing is to put in place, like you have in many of the laws at the federal level, support that with the state laws to ensure that there's a process of transparency and accountability is fully enforced at the local government level.
My position is that, look, you can't solve a problem by running away from it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that is Nigeria's mentality usually to problems.
That's my own.
What I know for sure is that, look, we've seen even here in Lagos where local government elections were conducted. You know, people were waiting for the results to be announced local government by local government. But the head of the commission simply sat down and said the APC has won everything. This party has lost everything. Come on. We saw that here. I mean, we're all with this.
Yes.
And, you know, it's not just here. I mean, we've seen that in other states as well. That the PDP
is a general
the hope is that this new guidelines now would help in reforming some of this process.
We have quite a number of beautiful laws or policies like this. It now behooves
the people to get the citizens now.
Yeah,
yes,
exactly.
To
take up
that's
from that. So
now.
I mean, that's
quite
beauty.
A number of beautiful
yeah,
laws.
The beauty of it is that they're coming up. So we need to challenge the system to start.
And another thing is that, look, I also think that this would also begin to force some serious people to consider running for local government elections.
Yeah, exactly.
Especially when they know the kind of powers
that they now have.
It will reattract interest in local government administration.
Exactly.
You know, that is very, very lacking
even till now.
All right, let's take a short break. When we come back, I would also want us to look at, a particular state where, and a community where there's just every evidence that local government administration is completely failing there. And it's what we have almost across the country. So we'll take a short break and we'll be right back. On Digi360, we don't just ask the questions. What is wrong with amending the Constitution the way the National Assembly members have been doing it? We seek answers.
Constitution is constituent.
Our problem is not lack of laws. Our problem is lack of the will power to implement our laws.
Answers that provide clarity.
While we negotiate, we should try to make it a point that the girls must be complete.
The clarity you need to make informed judgment so that you can make the right decision and take action.
People are saying it is you politicians that are responsible for this, that you are the reason why this is happening.
All these dullards that call themselves governors in this country?
I wish we had people like Tony at the National Assembly.
God forbid that I go to join that
Digi360, providing clarity to issues.